So the way it works is there are a number of big observatories around the world, and there are a number of astronomers around the world, and obviously they all want to use the big telescopes, and there's, you know, more of them wanting to use the telescopes than there is time available. So we have to have some mechanism for deciding who actually gets to use the telescopes, what science gets done. It depends on the telescope. So for something like the Hubble Space Telescope, which, you know, is one of the premier facilities out there, then you're probably talking oversubscription rates of about a factor of 10. So people want 10 times as much time on the telescope as there is available. For some of the littler telescopes, it gets down to a factor of 2 or 3. You have to fight off the other astronomers before you get to use it. We have this standard mechanism that gets used for lots of different things, whether it's assessing qualities of grant applications or scientific papers or whatever, called peer review, which essentially means that whatever you propose to do, whatever you write, gets sent to other astronomers who kind of weigh it up against all the other applications. In using telescopes, the way this works is probably twice a year is the usual way these things work. There's a call for applications, and then there's a peer review panel, basically a collection of astronomers who come from the community, and the peer review panel sifts their way through all these applications, grades them all, figure out which of them get the telescope time. They're supposed to be these, you know, honest brokers in this process, these disinterested parties. And, you know, if there's an obvious conflict of interest, like, you know, if it's your own telescope application, obviously you don't get to assess it. So there are ways for dealing with a very direct conflict of interest, but really they're just people that the community puts trust in, if you like. It varies a bit from panel to panel. They all tend to work in different ways. Some of them you actually sort of give a grade to the proposals before you even meet, and then you get together and you compare your grades and kind of refine them from there. Others you sort of start from scratch in the meeting. In some of them, everyone assesses all the proposals in detail. In others, there's sort of one or two members of the panel are kind of the lead for each application. You have to give a score in the end because you have to decide, you know, which one's better than which one. So you need some way of actually ordering things to decide which ones actually get the telescope time. The problem is just the amount of work involved. And this thing came to a head a few years ago when I was on the ESO telescope application panel. It's a thing called the OPC. And so this was the pile of papers I received, which is just one set of proposals to look at. It's about 100 proposals, slightly over 100 proposals. It's this huge mass of papers, and as you can see, I've scribbled on the fronts of them just because as I'm going through, I'm scoring them, trying to decide, you know, which ones I like, which ones I don't like, even before I get to the meeting. The problem with this is it's such a big pile of papers that actually, even if, you know, it takes me about a week to go through this lot. It's a week solid work, and then I go off and do the panel, and that's another week solid work. So it's 2 weeks work just to do this process. And the problem is, even if I do as conscientious a job as I can, I score the first one. By the time I've got to number 97, I can't remember anything about number one. And so trying to score number 97 on the same scale that I scored number one, even if I do, you know, really a conscientious job, you just can't, because you just can't hold that much stuff in your head at once. What got me to thinking about this whole thing is actually when a pile like this arrived on my desk. And it was one of the, you know, it's the classic displacement activity in that, you know, when something like that comes along, you find all sorts of other things to do. And so, you know, you go and tidy your office and do all those kinds of things. But eventually I'd run out of displacement activities. And so rather than actually get on with assessing it, I started trying to think, is there some better way we could be doing this? The scheme I came up with is kind of a way of distributing the process amongst the astronomers. Instead of having a little panel to do this, let's have the whole community do it. The people who apply should be the people who actually do the assessment. And one of the other issues is, because astronomers do recognize this process is a little bit of a lottery as to whether or not you get time, there is this temptation to say, I'll put 5 proposals in because that way I'm more likely to get the telescope time. And at the moment, there's no penalty really for doing that. You annoy the panel a bit because they see your name coming up lots of times and you start irritating them. But actually, there isn't really a penalty. Whereas if you could come up with a scheme where if you put a load of applications in, you get a load of work back to do the assessment. The idea I came up with was this. Each application that comes in gets sent out to, say, 5, 6, 7 other people who've applied. So each person who applies will get a pile of, say, 7 or 8 other people's applications to look at. All they have to do is actually go through that list, go through that pile of applications they've got. So they haven't got 100, they've only got 7 or 8 to deal with. So it's a manageable thing. You can actually really read that 7 or 8 proposals very carefully. The only thing they then have to do is rank them. Say, this is the best one, this is the worst one. They don't give them scores, they don't give them anything else. This is the one I like the most, this is the one I like the least, and this is the order in between. And so everyone's looked at a different combination of 7 or 8 applications because they've been kind of randomly distributed, and obviously you don't get your own one back, and you have to be a bit careful. You make sure you don't get anyone from the Smithsonian Institution as you. So it's a little bit of care taken to make sure that there's not, you know, no chance for dishonesty in this process. And it turns out this is a solved problem. How you actually do that, it's a thing called a board account. You've got these individual little ranked lists, and you've got to somehow got to compile it into this global list. That essentially means that you've got to give every proposal a score that you can then order to, so that the thing with the highest score ends up at the top and the thing with the lowest score ends up at the bottom. And this modified border count is actually very simple in that all you do is, supposing you had eight proposals, each person had eight proposals to look at, all they do is they rank the list, they then give 7 points to the top one, six to the next, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. So everything ends up with a score between 0 and n minus 1, where n's the number of applications you looked at, okay? Each application has been looked at by eight different people. That means that there are eight scores for each proposal, somewhere in that ranked list, so somewhere between 0 and 7, you just add them up. So then the sum of those then gives you the score that each applications get. And obviously, if you're near the top in everyone's little ranked sublist, you'll get something close to 7 each one, you'll end up with a nice high score. If you're near the bottom, you'll end up with something close to 0. That then gives you a score that you can then globally combine to create this master list of all the applications. And actually, there's an astronomical connection in this, in that the guy Border, who invented this, was an astronomer. And the reason why he invented it is because he thought that he was trying to get into the National Academy in France, and he thought that the voting was being rigged against him. So he got very interested in electoral theory and how you can actually come up with ways of dealing with these kinds of things to actually make sure that, you know, that the final vote ends up honest. And so this modified border count that I ended up using to rank all these things together actually came from him, but obviously applied to something rather different here, how you actually rank all these proposals together.
Call me a cynic, but one of the first thing that comes into my head is that if I'm in this contest and I see one that I think is outstanding and definitely is going to beat mine, I would have an interest in penalising that one and putting it at the bottom of my list.
So here's the trick. And in fact, so this gets into this whole thing called mechanism design of how you stop people gaming systems, or at least how you make them game a system in the way you want them to do it, which is the following, that once you've created this global list, you then go back to everyone's little sublist, their own little 7 or 8 that they've assessed, and you see whether the global list, where those 7 or 8 things appear in the global list, more or less agree with where they, the order that they put them in. Not completely, because as I say, once in a while people will disagree and all those kinds of things. But actually, the thing that you ranked the top kind of appear somewhere near the top of the global list, the thing that you ranked at the bottom appear somewhere near the bottom of the global list, and so on. Because that's an indication that actually the way you ranked it more or less agreed with everybody else. So that's fine. But if you find somebody where, you know, everybody else who looked at that proposal said it was really good, but you said it was rubbish, you start suspecting, well, maybe there's some game that's been going on exactly along these lines, that maybe it was your competitor and you were trying to do them down. So if your little sub-ranked list disagrees with the global list and it looks like you've been playing that game, your proposal moves down the pile. So you have an incentive to be honest, because actually you're invested in this process, you want your proposal to be as near the top of the pile as possible. If you agree more or less with what everybody else assessed, your application moves up a bit. If you disagree with what everybody else says about the proposals, your application moves down the list. So you actually have a strong incentive not to cheat.
If you're interested in astronomy and would like to learn more about deep space and the world's best telescopes, why not check out our sister channel called Deep Sky Videos? We go inside all sorts of amazing observatories there. And if you've got more questions about this video, don't worry, so did I, and you can hear some of them answered in an extra film we've already posted over on Deep Sky Videos.
So this is the main criticism that's been levelled at this as a way of doing things, and I'm happy to concede it is a point.